Good afternoon, everybody. This is Dr. Serge. And again, today I have the pleasure to speak with my good friend, Dr. Bob. Good to see you today.
You know what? Great to be seen. Always better to share fabulous information with you. I love our conversations, and I think we've got a good topic today.
We have a really exciting topic, and a topic that is important to talk about, right? There's a bit of confusion when it comes to that topic, and it's about immunity, the immune system. It seems that things are getting worse out there. If you watch the news, right, it seems that it's not getting any better. So we're going to start basic and really go over a few topics, and we'll see if people have any questions for you about immune system, immunity, and all that. So first of all, can you give us a breakdown of what is the immune system? Okay, there's two parts, right? And the immune system is used to fight infections. So can you break it down a little bit for us? Because people are a little bit confused when it comes to what we need to do for the immune system.
All right, well, let's just talk about the immune system's function. It's designed to protect us. And what's very, very fascinating, I'm going to take a few steps back.
Yes.
Because the immune system and the nervous system are actually derived from the same embryologic tissue. And when you look, there's a term called psychoneuroimmunology, and this has been around for, you know, decades. And the way they came up with that is they realized that every single chemical that affects the central nervous system also affects the immune system, and vice versa. So if they're derived from the same tissue, they use the same receptors, the same chemicals, and then keep in mind the nervous system surveys, you know, the external environment and then elicits an appropriate response to protect us.
Yeah.
The immune system surveys the internal environment and then will have a response to protect us. The conclusion is the immune system is a circulating nervous system. And as you said, there's two parts, right? We can use immune cells to kill things, or we can actually use antibodies for that process. They're called cellular immunity and humoral immunity.
And people get a little bit, I would use the term obsessed with antibodies, right? Because they do all those different tests and blood work to make sure that you have the antibodies. But the first step of the immune system, like you just said, when the body is exposed to a foreign antigens, different components, the cellular immunity kicks in.
Absolutely. You know, it recognizes, you know, your immune system knows which cells are yours. And interestingly enough, it also knows which cells are healthy. So let's go with this idea of understanding what cells are yours. Most people know that if they wanted to get an organ transplant, they can't take a random person and say, well, I'm going to take your liver because it's healthy and put it in my body, because there's this process called rejection. And what that means, very simply, is the immune system says, wait a minute, that's not your liver. It's a foreign protein. I'm going to kill it. And that's what it does. So whether people have a leaky gut, which so many people do, they get foreign proteins in the system, the body begins to attack it. They call that a food allergy, but it's really a good immune response to a foreign protein in the system from a leaky gut that we can resolve. But it's got to recognize it. It's got to see it as something friendly. And if it is, then it says you can stay. And if it's not, it can go. And Dr. Serge, you look eager to say something. So I'm going to say one more thing about that. You know, it's estimated that everybody walking around, everybody, generates between 500 and 1,000 cancer cells a day. So when our immune system sees a cell that is ours but became unhealthy, it kills that cell. And it should. Otherwise, we'd all have cancer and we'd all die from it.
Wow, this is really interesting. So at the end of the day, we all have cancer in the body. But if you have a healthy body, you're maintaining the cells. You're killing the cells.
Absolutely.
That's fascinating. And this cellular immunity starts a few hours, I believe, right? This is a quick response, right? When you're exposed to a virus or bacteria, within a few hours, your body starts to produce these reactions.
Well, I think within a few hours, it's measurable and recognizable, but I really think it's even faster than that. You know, the body is always looking out. It sees something. It says, okay, let's get some friends involved. And as the immune system recruits itself, that's where we can measure it in the laboratory, if that's what we choose to do.
Yeah.
But your body's on it.
It's crazy, huh? And then we have the second part of the immune system, the adaptive or acquired immune system. It takes, they say, like 7 to 10 days, right, to get to that place and so on. I think that's why they say it takes about a week to get rid like of the flu virus, for example.
Yeah, you know, and what's fascinating is that memory is not brief. You know, the adaptive part, it's long-term memory. And that's why when children have childhood issues, most of the time it doesn't come back. So it's very, very fascinating. You know, yeah. A lot of people are familiar with the chicken pox, and someone gets chicken pox when they're 3 or 4 years old. Well, that virus is actually inserted its DNA into your DNA. And if you get beat down enough, it can actually reemerge. And so someone 73 or 74, 7 decades later, suddenly gets the shingles. But that's because they're, you know, they're not taking good care of their immune system.
Yes. You know, I was listening to an immunologist, a virologist on YouTube. She was doing a talk and she was talking about a case that she saw. You may have seen that video. She's from Harvard and she was talking about antibodies and immune system. And she was studying a case where the guy had this genetic conditions where he couldn't make antibodies. So he just had the first response in the immune system. There was no antibodies productions at all. But the guy was healthy. The guy was living like anybody else. So why are we so obsessed with antibodies these days? Because it doesn't seem to be the most important part of the immune system. The first part seems to be the primary key, right? What's your take on that?
Well, that case displays it very, very effectively. And then even, you know, there's a virus out there that we're probably better off not naming because they might strike down this video.
Yeah.
But, you know, they came to realize that when people had the virus and they beat it, there's a procedure called convalescent plasma that's been around for over 100 years. That was the very first Nobel Prize in medicine. They take the fluid from my blood, since I beat the virus, and they infuse it into someone that's fighting it. And the two studies that they published, they were small studies, but Journal of the American Medical Association, Proceeds National Academy of Science, they had 100% recovery. 100% recovery in people that got convalescent plasma.
Wow.
And what they came to realize over time was they started testing some of these things for antibodies. They didn't have antibodies, but yet they were still transferring something that was very helpful. So there's a lot more to the story.
Wow. So are you saying that the plasma contained those macrophages or cells that are actually primed to kill the virus?
Well, either that or it contained a signal in the way that the patient's immune system could interpret it, where it could mount an attack. Whatever it was that was in there, it was still effective.
So that was not the antibodies doing it. This is so fascinating. So that confirms the case of that doctor was looking at that guy who cannot make antibodies. So there's something else going on that we don't really know when it comes to the immune system.
Well, here's what I'm going to say. I think what we know is maybe this much. What we don't know, if I could, you know, if you could see my arms spread out all the way around the globe, what we don't know is infinitely more than what we do know. That's for sure.
Yes. So let's talk about the immune system and what they are pushing so hardly right now. If you look at the news or watch the news, you know what I'm talking about. This experiment, right, that you said initially, it was not really an actual medical procedure. I don't know what term to use it. You use the term shot, but it's a technology that they are pushing right now. And based on my understanding, I'm not an immunologist, but that kind of technology bypasses the cellular immunity and goes straight to make antibodies. And to me, that's the mistake we're doing with this type of medical procedures.
Well, let's take back and figure out what they really do. They took genetic material that made a particular protein that they like to call spike protein. Now understand that, you know, viruses mutate all the time. And there was 30 identified mutations before March of 2020, 100 identified mutations, and it keeps going. But we also know that in nature, a virus mutates to a less harmful form because if it kills its host, it doesn't stay around. So by creating artificial environment, well, they're allowing this virus to go in a direction that goes against nature. But they inject genetic material packaged in little things called nanoparticles so it can get into any cell. And then it uses the cell's material, genetic material, the RNA, ribonucleic acid, to make copies of the spike protein, and they can be released everywhere in the body. Well, if you ask what specific cells does this nanoparticle containing the genetic material go into? Well, the answer is it's nonspecific. It can go into any cell it comes in contact with. And then once they have the spike proteins, where do they go? Well, the brain, the heart, the liver, the kidneys, the lungs, the reproductive organs, the pancreas. And, you know, if people wanted to know, they could, you know, type in the Google search, spike protein autopsy report on whatever you want to call it, related death, you know.
Yeah.
And what you're going to find out is they found out that all the tissues were massively infiltrated with spike proteins, and it led to the death of the individual.
Yeah, actually, I had a guest yesterday on my podcast, and she, that's what she was mentioning. We were talking about why a woman had a hard time to get pregnant. And she was mentioning that the spike protein targeted the ovaries and the uterus. And that's one of the reasons why we see all those women walking around and starting to have hormonal imbalances, hormonal issues.
You know, we're learning more and more every day, but here's what we know. When people do things naturally or in a proven way, there's a few drugs that are helpful. By the way, the drugs that are helpful were derived from natural molecules.
Yes.
So the most popular podcast in the world is a guy named Joe Rogan. And yes. I don't know how many tens of millions of people listen every month, but he got a virus very recently.
Yeah.
And he did high-dose vitamin C infusions, oral vitamin C, vitamin D, zinc, and a drug called ivermectin. And then CNN published that he was taking a horse deworming drug. And he even got on his podcast. He says, they know that's a blatant lie. Why would they share a blatant lie? He went to his doctor, and his doctor prescribed this drug, which, by the way, won a Nobel Prize in 2015 and is among the list of the safest drugs ever, ever, ever discovered. You know, 3.7 billion doses is what they recommend it's been given. Only 4,000 adverse events, and that makes it magnitude safer than aspirin.
I was going to say that, yes, it's much safer. There's a lot of confusion around this drug for sure. We have a question coming in from Miss Jennifer. We can sit at the bottom. So what about parasites in the body?
Well, you know, you're certainly an expert at that. And, you know, here's what I'm going to tell people. Here's what my mentors taught me. Parasites only attack weak tissue. So ultimately, if you get really, really strong, you don't have a problem with those setting up in your body. Now, if you've had that challenge, then ultimately there's a number of natural products that can be very effective. Gentian, wormwood are a couple that come to mind, golden seal, berberine. But reality is some of these things are cleared more effectively by pharmaceuticals. And, you know, when you look at the U.S., our labs do not seem very good at stool analysis. They really don't.
No.
And so I've literally had patients, I know this will sound like a really strange thing, take their stool into a veterinarian because the veterinarian is very familiar with parasites.
Yes.
And 9 times out of 10, the veterinarian makes a very appropriate prescription recommendation, and they get rid of it in a matter of days or maybe a week or two, because some of them, you know, they lay eggs and you have to do a couple different treatments.
Yeah.
But that's the way I would go with it.
This is a good point, because one of my friends is a vet, and she says that she believes that all pets have parasites. She doesn't trust the tooth test. She just dewormed them once or twice a year and so on. Here's an interesting question that Jennifer asked. Trying to connect different dots here. All parasites, viruses. And what about the connections between exosome, virus, parasite? I know there's a lot of people talking about exosome. I've talked about exosome in the past. So are viruses exosome at the end of the day? So what's the connection with all these different
parts? Well, there are certainly people that are making that argument, and they're very educated people. So, you know, if you think about what does a parasite do, it actually is going to live off of your body in a way that takes from you and doesn't give back. And you know what? I guess in theory, we could call a virus a parasite, even though viruses are so tiny. They're on the range of something like 100 nanometers. Which, by the way, means even if you wore an N95 respirator mask, the pores on the medical respiration mask are much bigger than the virus itself.
Yes.
And so viruses can even get through there. And that's well documented and well covered. So, you know, we tend to reserve the parasite label for things that are macroscopic rather than microscopic, but in theory, you could be right. Now, what's an exosome? Here's what I tell people. Every cell we have eats, drinks, and goes to the bathroom.
Yeah.
And when they eat, there's a process called endocytosis. You bring something into the cell in a way that you can be nourished with it. Then there's exocytosis, things you get rid of, waste products, things that the cell doesn't want. And could viruses, could viral genetic material be in these exosomes? Yeah, they could. And there is some debate about whether or not all viruses are that. And you know, there's even some data suggesting by really powerful worldwide people that this virus that's recent wasn't the only major catastrophe that was man-made. Some other viruses, which have been horrific for humanity, they're saying the evidence is starting to look now like those were man-made as well.
I've heard stories about that. It's really crazy when you look into this concept when it comes to virus and different things. You know, in December, last December, I watched a video from Dr. Luc Montagnier. You know, he's the Nobel Prize for the HIV virus discovery. Long time ago, I don't remember when he got the Nobel Prize. But Dr. Luc is retired, right? And he's really outspoken when it comes to this pandemic. And in December, he said that if you start doing this medical procedure at big scale, you're going to end up with mutants, what we call variants, right? So what's going on with those variants? Because it seems that all viruses have variants. And what do we need to do to really support our immune system against those different mutants?
Yeah, and you know, you don't have to look very far to find hundreds of thousands of doctors that are agreeing with this. And so just for sake of saying something, I watched a Zoom yesterday, and there was a group of nurses in Minnesota talking to a Minnesota politician, and 70 to 80% of them are refusing what we're going to call the jab. And he asked them, why would you refuse that? And they said, well, first and foremost, 75% of the people in the intensive care unit have been fully jabbed, got double jabbed.
Wow.
And then they also said, we've seen adverse events, including death in people that have the jab. So here's what we know. There's not enough evidence that it works, and there's plenty of evidence that it's not safe. Why in the world would we do that? So now you're starting to talk about these variants. And so they're creating a breeding ground. When you put, you know, so many people, when you make them spike protein factories, you're going to compromise, not enhance, compromise their immune system. And then when the virus gets in, it has so many different ways that it can change.
Yeah.
And you know, there's more data out there than we can look at. The head of Pfizer, the company that made one of the shots, refuses to take the shot.
I wonder why.
Yeah, well, you know, we would think that if that were your life and that was your life's work and you were really excited about it, you'd do it. You'd be you'd be an example instead of an example of someone saying, no, this is not a good idea.
So the whole concept of mutants reminds me of this phenomenon when it comes to antibiotic resistance, right?
Mm-hmm.
We've been using antibiotics for decades, and those are bacterial resistant. And I was talking with a state epidemiologist, actually in Texas, and he looks at the population of different childhood illnesses, like the chickenpox and different viruses and bacteria. And they are starting to see the same phenomenon in those different shots, that the shots right now don't match the genetic material of those pathogens anymore, and they are expecting to see these diseases coming back.
You know, I think they're right. You know, and the real question might be how many people are going to be around to get them. You know, because let's face it, there. You know, I had a patient come in, and we'll say that he was having jab remorse. And he said, Dr. Bob, I don't feel very good. You know, I was healthy all my life. I was an athlete and I feel terrible.
Yeah.
Well, we ran a very comprehensive panel, and he's got two different definable by blood markers, autoimmune diseases going on.
Wow.
That there was no evidence that any of that existed before. And then a lot of his other chemistry is quite off too. So, and he says, it happened. I wish I wouldn't have done that. Now what can I do? And that's an evolving question too. What can they do?
So that was my next question. So what can we do when people did get it? Or what can we do to make sure we don't get sick from the shedding of the S-protein, shedding from the shot, from the virus and all that? So what can we do? What are the answers to that?
Well, I'm gonna defer to the doctor that actually treated President Trump. He has successfully treated over 6,000 patients with the virus. And he says for people that have had the jab, it's going to be exceptionally important that they never get the viral infection or any type of coronavirus infection, because they might have what's called antigen priming. And they can have such an immune attack that cytokine storm that they were talking about. In previous trials to try to create, you know, a shot like this, all of the animals died when they were reinfected. That should be a big enough warning for all of us. But that information, they're not getting out. So he said, never get it. So keep the immune system strong. He's a big fan of vitamin D, vitamin C, zinc. You and I might throw in things like reishi and colostrum.
Yes.
And those are just fantastic ways to stay ahead of it. Time will tell. But prevention trumps cure, you know. Don't put yourself in a circumstance where you're so vulnerable for something that has limited effectiveness.
So do you think that those deaths that they are reporting currently are related to this cytokine storm? Because I've seen people getting the jab, right? And like you said, the immune system goes like all crazy.
Well, that's part of it, you know. And when you, again, if you go to that pathologist report, they found that all of the organs were so infiltrated with spike proteins that they had multi-organ failure. And interestingly enough, even though they don't have any warning labels in the vaccine insert, it's completely blank. And one of the companies says purposely left blank. Some of the side effects that they found were multi-organ inflammatory process, which can lead to multi-organ failure.
So there's a lot of the doctors that I listen to that are really concerned for this second wave, the next wave coming, those people who got the medical procedure, they may be exposed to the virus, and what will happen? We don't really know, but it's really concerning when you think about that. So based on your own experience, is it a way to detox those nanoparticles and those the stuff from those medical procedures?
Well, we're still looking. You know, I put people on good detox programs, good immune system programs, and they start to feel better. So, you know, ultimately, can it help in the short term? We know that, but the long term is yet to unfold.
Yeah.
And if they've actually changed your genes, which they have, they've injected viral spike protein genetic material that's taken up by any cell that it can get into, you know, will that always be there? Well, some people are saying it certainly looks like that. Time will tell.
Yeah. So what about those tissues, you know, that people wear on their faces? I remember at the beginning of the pandemic, Dr. Fauci, our good friend Dr. F, said that you needed 20 layers of cloth in order to have the same benefit as the N95. And now they're claiming that one layer is good enough. And now we see all those school systems and the governments and different places to require again those masks, right? So is that something that we should be concerned about? Does it really affect our oxygen level in the bloodstream? Because that's the main argument, right?
Sure. You can see, you know, people that have instruments that measure oxygen and OSHA instruments, Occupation Safety and Health Administration instruments, and they'll put it under the mask. And then they see that the oxygen drops, the carbon dioxide rises. And that's not healthy. You know, carbon dioxide is going to acidify the body. It's going to decrease the ability to carry that oxygen to cells. And, you know, first thing that's going to suffer is your brain. And then you stop making good decisions. And, you know, there's people on the other side of it that are saying, well, they're trying to, you know, give people less functional brains so they don't think through this. Now, you know, that's certainly an opinion, but that they're getting less oxygen, that's a fact.
Yeah.
And that's a problem.
I mean, the counter argument to that is people will tell me, listen, surgeons work in OR for 10, 12, 15 hours. They wear masks all day long. They are fine.
Yeah. And by the way, the operating air room quality is beyond phenomenal, right? Highly, highly, highly filtered. I don't know if they're doing anything with improved oxygen. But let's put it this way, you know, if you couldn't wear a mask for 12 hours or however long it would be, you're never going to get through medical school. So, you know, there are people that can tolerate it better than others. If it was required and you know, they suddenly got brain fog and headachey and couldn't succeed in a surgery, guess what? They're not a surgeon. So
true. Those people must be adapted to it. And the mask that they use in the OR, it's part of the PPE. It's part of the whole suit that they wear. It's not to prevent infection at the end of the day. It's to have the bacterial infection, right, coming from the breath or the skin cells that can fall into the wood or the surgery area. So it has nothing to do with preventing infection based on my understanding.
Well, and keep in mind, then they also have the patient in a way masked up because they're breathing that way. And so they're certainly, and they're getting really good quality oxygen. So
that makes a big difference.
Absolutely.
It makes me cringe to see all those kids, 2 or 3 years old, walking around with those. I've seen N95s on those kids or just masks at the end of the day. I think we are trying to get them used to or brainwashed to believe that's the next step.
Well, and by the way, the World Health Organization already announced that the next pandemic is coming with a different virus called the MERS virus. So,
I didn't know that. When it's supposed to come?
Well, that's a good question. they're already working on the vaccine. So, there you have it.
This is crazy. Yeah. I mean, the Bible does mention pestilences. So there's going to be a lot of pandemics at the end time, right? So I think we are getting so close.
This one's man-made, every part of it, unfortunately. You look at immunologists, world-renowned immunologists that said, we never should have shut down anything. Take the people that were 75 and health compromised and protect them for a month. Everybody else go out and interact and get it. And at the end of that month, the virus would be gone. Herd immunity
Countries like Sweden, right? They didn't do much and they don't have any wave of virus over there.
No,
it's ridiculous.
Smart country. Yeah. Smartest country that I know of so far.
Exactly. So let's end this podcast on a good note. So what can people do, can take as first steps to get them better, immune system or just their health?
Well, I tell people the enemies of the immune system are stress and sugar. So do things that make you happy. And remember, the number one way to get happy is to share happy. If you bring joy to people, it's going to automatically spill over to joy for you. And then, of course, you know, the most effective program is one that people are excited to do. So, you know, I see your banner going across for reishi-infused coffee. People drink on the average 3.3 cups a day. You know, you drink that, you get a really good immune booster. And if you go to PubMed.gov and you type in reishi and the virus we're talking about, you're going to find out there's a really good study that it's proven against it. Take the vitamin T, take the vitamin C, take the zinc. Eat a really good diet. Stay away from processed foods, processed sugars. Get some sunshine. Breathe fresh air. You know, when you get outside and you're among the plants, plants have an immune system. And when we breathe the air from the plants, we actually get the plant's immune system. And it has proven health benefit. They're called phytoncides with a P-H-Y-T-O, phytoncides. So, you know, live healthy, live happy, share health, share happy. And you know, we're going to get through this, but make really good choices.
And I like the way what you said, the happiness, because when you look at the blue zone, right, I was really surprised by that, actually, because we talk about the blue zone, and we always talk about the diet, what they eat, but what they all have in common, it's not the diets, because they all have different diets, but they all seem to have optimal happiness. So...
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, even if happy didn't help us to live longer, it'd certainly help us to live better, wouldn't it? And the data shows it's both.
That's true. So, Dr. Bob, it was really a pleasure to have you again today. We'll see you next month. We're going to talk about something else.
Our time flies. I always appreciate you, Dr. Serge. Thanks for making our wonderful world better.
Yeah. Thank you. God bless you.
And you.
Thank you.